Well, good morning and welcome to Calvary. You're awake now. Thank you for being here. We are all about connecting people to God here at Calvary, and I'm glad that you are here this morning as we look forward to praising our Almighty Father. As we connect people to God, we want to connect you with each other. So would you please take a moment, stand up, welcome those around you, find a new face, and say hello this morning. Praise the Lord. Well, thank you for being here. You can find your seats. You can have a seat. I just want to welcome you here this morning. My name is Pastor Josh. I'm the Family Life and Discipleship Pastor, and it is a pleasure to have you here this morning. I'm excited to worship the Lord this morning. Are you guys excited to be here and worship Almighty God? That's what we're all about. It's bringing glory to His name. One of the things I want to mention to you, we have a few things coming up that I want to bring you up to speed on. You might notice the stage is a little different. Today we have the Legacy 5 concert we're excited about. We still need a few volunteers. If you're interested, see this guy right over here. Pastor John will take care of you. Also was informed this morning that I have 3 tickets that someone is not going to be able to use. So if you wanted to go today and you couldn't afford it, or last minute you're like, I need tickets, I have 3 that are available. Find me after the service and I can connect you with that person. Also coming up, if you take your connector and you peek in that, there's an insert that has a lot of information. One of them is freezer meals. There's an event for you ladies to come and put together freezer meals. This is not like an assembly line where you all make the same recipe. Bring your own ingredients, bring your own recipes. It's just about gathering to fellowship and make some meals. And then at the end of the event, we ask you to donate 1 or 2 items to the church freezer for when people are in need and need some additional meals. So make sure you check out that information. Also coming up in our Kids Link program is the Fuel Conference that we like to take part of every year. If you want more information on that, if you have a student that's 4th, 5th, or 6th grade and you want to know what that is, please stop at the Kids Link desk out in the atrium. Also coming up, you'll notice on your insert, is Converge. That's our young adult ministry here, 18 to 29-year-olds. They're starting a new study, Balancing Life's Demands, starting on March 26th. And 2 nights before that study starts, there is a movie night right here at Calvary. So make sure you find out more information on that. It's all in your connector. One thing that's not on the slide insert in your connector is this week for our Awana ministry is shop night. We do the Awana Grand Prix every year where the kids make a Pinewood Derby car. And this week we're having shop night at 6 o'clock. If you need an address on that of where you can come, cut your car, sand it, have all the tools available for you, please see me. I will make sure that you have the information you need. And men, if you're available and you want to help with those cars as people need help, please find me. We could use all the additional hands as if you want to help with that. Those are the announcements I have for you. Please stay tuned in your connector with what's happening around here and enter into our time of call to worship. Here's Pastor John.
Thank you, Josh. Let me just clarify something I think. I'm going to make sure I get this right. The reason we're having shop night is because it's spring break and there is no actual Awana Club Wednesday night, right?
Yep.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I am excited about what God is going to do today, and the reason is because every time something happens in my life that discourages me or causes me some heartache, I know that that is Satan distracting me from something that God is planning to really do. So power up, everybody, and get ready. Romans 8, would you stand with me, please? Listen to this incredible passage of promise from God. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to His purpose. Amen. For those whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son in order that He might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom He predestined, He also called. And those whom He called, He also justified. And those whom He justified, He also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also with Him graciously give us all things? Let's pray together. Our Father, we humble ourselves before You right now, the Almighty God, the one and only true God, the God of creation, the God of sovereign control over all creation, and the God who has a redemptive purpose for all that is lost in creation, including and especially human beings created in Your image. Lost because of the effects of sin, saved by faith alone in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross, redeemed from the eternal effects of sin, because God is doing it all for good. And it is for good that we repent of our sins. It is for good that we confess our sins and admit responsibility for them. It is for good that we, by faith, accept what Jesus did in payment for those sins. It is for eternal good that God grants us, through Jesus, eternal life and victory over all things. He is for us, so nothing and no one can be against us. And we praise You for that truth today. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Put your hands together, church. Come on.
Here we go. One, two, three, and.
Father, we believe that You are able.
God is able, He will never fail.
That's right. He is Almighty God. Oh, it's greater, greater than all we see, greater than all we ask. He has done great things.
Sing it out.
Lifted up, yeah. He defeated the grave, raised to life. That our God is greater, that our God is stronger.
Amen. You may be seated. It's so easy sometimes to gather in the presence of fellow believers and shout those words and proclaim that, but I'm convicted of whether or not I mean that in all areas of my life. Am I willing to stand and say over my finances, over my family, over my struggles, that God is greater and more powerful and he's worthy of our praise no matter what? And as we enter into a time of prayer, as the ushers come forward, would you please contemplate that in your hearts? Let's pray. Father, we do know that you are awesome in power. Father, we know from your scriptures that you are greater, that you are stronger. Father, sometimes we don't always show that. Would you please, this morning, Holy Spirit, convict us of those places that we need our faith to be stronger, that we need to fully make you, Jesus, King over our lives, not just in certain compartments, but everywhere. Lord, start right here in this place, changing the world through the hearts of the people here who are committed to say that their faith needs to be stronger, that they're willing to shout that you are greater than anything, not just in these four walls, but they're willing to do it in their jobs, in their households, and everywhere that they go. Father, we long to be your faithful servants. I pray that we would make that commitment even more serious here this morning. Father, take these resources that you are about to get from your people, that we are willingly understanding what it means to be generous, that we are responding out of our faith, that we know that you are greater. Would you please take these resources and glorify your name, not just here, not just in Eau Claire or the Chippewa Valley, but worldwide. Thank you for being a God who is worthy of our praise, faithful, and who allows us the privilege to serve. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So introduce to us who you are and what ministry you're involved with here at Calvary.
So my name is Nathan Deitch, and I'm in charge of the ministry See To It. See To It is, our mission statement is demonstrating the power of Christ in us through serving the family of God. And we're going to be doing that through a mission trip in Watertown, South Dakota, at the Midwest Bible Camp. And that is run by Hank Rosso. And we're going to be traveling up there April 6th through the 9th. We'll be leaving around 8 a.m. in the morning on the 6th and arriving back somewhere in the evening of the 9th, which is a Sunday. So we'll be having when we go up there, there's the construction that needs to be done up there. Is there's some children's bathrooms, there's some plumbing, there's some carpentry work that needs to be done. Everyone is encouraged to come. If there's some ladies that would like to help with the meals, we encourage couples to be coming if they're interested. I also just want to mention that we'll also be on Sunday, we'll be having fellowship at the church up there. There are rooms available for individuals if needed, and couples also if needed.
That sounds great, and that's April 6th through the 9th. Everyone is welcome to come, and they can contact you for more details, right?
That's right.
Sounds great.
Amen. What a great ministry. What a great ministry opportunity. Let's continue our worship this morning. Thank you.
against me, but I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war. I will not fear the storm. My help is on my way. That's right, Father. My help is on the way. Oh, my God, He will not delay. My refuge and strength always. And I will not fear. His promise is true. My God will come through always, always.
Yours is the victory.
Amen. Let's give him a shout. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Amen. You may be seated. That's such an incredible introduction to what we're going to study from God's Word today. But before we get to that, while kids are going out to their ministry time, the younger children in the church, I just want to emphasize something about the concert this afternoon and ask for your help. I'm gonna take full responsibility for the irresponsibility of it. But it's been really hectic and busy, and I can't find anywhere my list of volunteers to help today for the concert. Those who are helping with load-in right after church, which, by the way, don't stack your chairs after church, but we do have to reposition them a little bit. So you could stay and help with that for a little if you want, and we'll give direction for that. We're going to need to help bring in the equipment for Legacy 5 and move some of this off and bring in the equipment on, and we need help with that right after church today. And then I know there's people that volunteered for this. I just can't remember who you are, so I'm just really spacing out, and I won't be able to focus on the message unless we get this done. So I need ticket takers. I need somebody to sell tickets at the door today for people that come. I need ushers. Okay, so people that can be here at 1:30 to 2 o'clock to help with that stuff, and then at 5:30 this afternoon, gonna need people who can help take the equipment down and put it back on their bus. So if you're available today, I would really appreciate it, and please forgive me for not having that more organized today, but I lost all the stuff from the last concert. That it was very confusing to me, and I'm old and I have lots of brain problems right now, so and your first thought was right now, right? Let's pray together. Our Father, we started this service with a recognition that if you are for us, no one, nothing can be against us. And the promise, the guarantee that you are doing all things for the good of those who love you and are called according to your purpose. And so the first thing that we need to do right now in preparation for this next study in the book of James is to refresh our minds again with the recommitment that we are devoted to your purpose. And your purpose is not defined by how wealthy we are or how healthy we are. Your purpose is not defined by how proficient we are or how efficient we are. Your purpose is not defined by how secure we are in who we are, but our description, definition, identity of who we are is found in who you are, and all of life is defined by what you say is your purpose for our lives, and that is to bring glory to you and to accept the incredible privilege of living according to your purpose, your eternal redemptive purpose to bring lost and hurting people in need of help to the ultimate help of saving faith in Jesus Christ for eternal life. That is our purpose. And it is in that faith that we then take action and get involved in that purpose. And this study of James, God, has been so refreshing for me to see all the activity of faith that we are to be involved in, and we have the privilege of being empowered by the Holy Spirit to do. But today, we need to figure out how to stick to it. How do we finish well? And so we listen to your word today so that we might win the race of life according to your race descriptions. And we thank you for humble hearts that will receive this truth today for the glory of Jesus. Amen. Amen. If you're here today and you don't have a Bible, or you're new and you don't, maybe you don't even have a Bible at home, but if you're here today and you need a Bible, we have some at the back that we would love to give you, and someone will bring you one if you would just put your hand up right now and say you need one. And if you like it so much that you'd like to take notes in it and keep it for yourself, you're welcome to keep it and take it home. So help yourself. If you don't need this, you're just borrowing it for today, put it on one of the tables at the back of the sanctuary here before you leave to go home so someone else has it available for them. Our foundational principle today is this. I think I jumped ahead, but if you could jump ahead to that foundational principle, because I want to share that as we begin, and then we're going to go back and read the passage of Scripture that this comes from, because as you know, at Calvary, every principle for life is taken directly from Scripture. So here's the foundational principle, and sorry for the misspelling up there, that's totally my fault. It was misspelled on my script, and so it was cut and pasted into the screens, and it's my fault for that unique new word, faux-inundational. Okay, so faux-inundational, the faux-inundational principle, and it's been corrected. Yay, thank you, Rebecca. Wow, do we have gifted people or what? Yes. Here's the foundational principle. Winning the race of life is not defined by wealth. Winning faith is defined by the determination to live in obedience to God's will in patient expectation of His return. Now you may say, why did you make that first statement, winning the race of life is not defined by wealth? You could have said anything there. No, I took it straight from Scripture, because the context of what James is talking about is wealthy people. The whole context of this is the pursuit of human wealth and prosperity as the means of defining what winning is in our lives. That's James's foundational principle to get us to understand the real principle and definition of winning faith, which is defined by the determination we have to live in obedience to God's will as we patiently wait for His return. Let's see where we get that from. Starting in James chapter 4, verse 13, reading all the way over through the 12th verse of chapter 5. Again, a lengthy passage, but we have to keep everything in context. So please stand in honor of God's word as we stand in His presence and hear directly from what He wrote to us. This is what God says. Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go into such and such a town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit. Yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. So whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it is sin. Come now, you rich, weep and howl for the miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches have rotted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded, and their corrosion will be evidence against you and will eat your flesh like fire. You have laid up treasure in the last days. Behold, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, are crying out against you, and the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on the earth in luxury and in self-indulgence. You have fattened your hearts in a day of slaughter. You have condemned, you have murdered the righteous person. He does not resist you. Be patient, therefore, brothers, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, being patient about it until it receives the early and late rains? You also be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble against one another, brothers, so that you may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. As an example of suffering and patience, brothers, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Behold, we consider those blessed who remained steadfast. You have heard of the steadfastness of Job, and you have seen the purpose of the Lord, how the Lord is compassionate and merciful. But above all, my brothers, do not swear either by heaven or by earth or by any other oath, but let your yes be yes and your no be no, so that you may not fall under condemnation. You may be seated. Do you see the contrast in the passage as to James, speaking in the first half of the passage to people who are rich and arrogant and boastful that life is all there is to live, so get the most you can from it all the time. And then all of a sudden, three times he uses the term, but for you, brothers. Now, you ladies, don't be left out of that. That's a generic term. It's like saying, hey, guys, okay? It's boys and girls there. It's all those who are members of the family of God in the body of Christ. But he contrasts writing in the first half to people who were not in the family of God by the evidence of their life, by the pursuit of their wealth and the pursuit of their prosperity. They are demonstrating that they do not have true faith that is active in God and how they live their life and make their decisions. And then he says, but for you brothers, here's how you are living as the activity of your faith in these last days. That's what we want to talk about today. What is winning faith? What is winning faith? And so again, our foundational principle is winning the race of life is not defined by wealth. Winning faith is defined by the determination to live in obedience to God's will in patient expectation of his return. That brings down into context all that James wrote. Let's dive into it and dissect it and understand it. Winning faith requires an understanding of God, of life, and of who we are. Three things in this passage that James brings out is that winning faith, if you're going to run that race of life to the finish line where Jesus Christ is standing, ready to say, well done, you were a good and faithful servant, what does it take to get that statement said when you break the ribbon at the end of the race? Winning faith requires an understanding of God, an understanding of life, and an understanding of who we are. Let's look at those things first. Number one, and by the way, you have brief notes in your connector, and again, we'll have the full script of this for your Bible studies at home and in your small groups and life groups. The full script of this will be available at the back, and all of the previous messages from the whole book of James are all there also. So you can have all the scripts from this sermon if you want to do an intense Bible study with someone about the book of James. They're all available back there in stapled or clipped all together, and if we run out, we'll just make more. So they're all done up through the taming of the tongue. Last week's and this week's are not there yet. There's a few copies of this week's if you want it, but we'll get last week's and this week's added to the bundle as soon as possible. The first point under this statement that winning faith requires an understanding of God and of life and of who we are is this. We must understand the sovereignty of God, the uncertainty of life, and that we don't take the future for granted. The very first thing James addresses here is to people who live life with this philosophy. Today or tomorrow, we're going to go do such and such in that town, and we're going to spend as much time as we want there, and by the time we're done, we're going to have a nice profit. Who are making all these business plans for the building of personal worth. The first people that James addresses are those people. And those are the people that do not understand the sovereignty of God. They do not understand the uncertainty of life, and they do not in any way, or they do rather, take the future for granted. You see, we have to understand in verse 16 what James says when he says, as it is, you boast in your arrogance. In other words, they do not understand that God controls every aspect of life, and he is to receive all the glory for our activities and our accomplishments. They boast in their activities. They boast in what they are doing. They boast in their plans. And they boast on the history of their plans having success. Therefore, I'm going to make plans for the future that lead to this great success 8 years from now, maybe 1 year from now, maybe even 5 days from now. And in doing so, they're boasting about their ability to control all the aspects of life and to guarantee that even 5 days from now will happen. They do not accept the uncertainty of life. And James points out to them some basic principles. He says, life is short. Life is short, so make the most of each day. The issue has to be, how do you define making the most of each day? Well, God defined it for us. The Apostle Paul defined it for us in one of his letters when he said, make the most of every opportunity to do good to others. Boy, that changes the concept because I thought making the most of every day was for my good. It was to bring me a benefit, bring me a profit, bring me something. Making the most of every day was about making my life better. No, making the most of every opportunity is about making someone else's life better, not your own. And people who are arrogant and who are not living out an active faith don't understand that life is short. And we must understand that since life is so brief, we cannot afford merely to spend our lives, and we certainly don't want to waste our lives. The only way to live life to its fullest is to invest our lives in things that are eternal. We don't spend our lives. We don't waste our lives. We invest our lives in the things that are eternal. And in order to do that, James warns in verse 15 that you don't make any plans that are not based on the will of God. You don't make any plans that are based on the will of God. I don't care how well that plan has been working out to this point. And I've had this happen to me. I've been 8 steps into a 10-step plan that every one of those 8 steps have worked to that point. And it would be easy to make the assumption when I get up tomorrow morning that it's ready for that I'm ready for step 9 and to just dive in tomorrow morning into step 9 without going back to God and saying, God, did you have a purpose for bringing me through the first 8 steps? And then all of a sudden, are you ready to say stop or go with the next step? Because maybe it's just in the first 8 steps that God taught you everything he wanted you to know and you don't need the completion of the plan. How do you know if you don't stop every day and ask God every day, what is your plan for today? To make the most of this day according to your will for my life. You see, we're a little bit deceived, aren't we, about how much we take the future for granted. Well, it's all worked out to this point, so it's got to have a completion. I got to get closure. The closure comes from God when he says stop. Or go, or just sit here for a while until I get the rest prepared because I'm not ready for you to go yet. That's your closure. The closure is always the affirmation of God's will in your life. So don't take the future for granted. And in your arrogance, don't make plans that are not the plans of God for your life, specific for that day. The second point about this general statement at the top is we must understand the importance of doing the right thing. If we're going to recognize the sovereignty of God and understand life and understand who we are, we have to understand the importance of doing the right thing. James says it this way, so whoever knows the right thing to do. In other words, in your heart, in your life, God has built into you an eternal ability to know right and wrong. Now that right and wrong, the knowledge of right and wrong, the knowledge of knowing the right thing to do, was corrupted when Adam and Eve chose to do the wrong thing, contrary to the will of God. So that the consequence of the evil came into existence. And now we struggle because the consequence of evil has enough fluff to it that is appealing that we make temporary decisions to do the evil, thinking that it will benefit us, and we ignore the consequence for the future of its destructive quality. God says in James 4, you know the right thing to do. Faith that wins always chooses to obey what God has said. Faith that wins always chooses to obey what God has said. But we also have to understand in this verse that we recognize the consequences of not doing the right thing. In other words, faith that wins always takes sin seriously. Faith that wins takes sin seriously. Whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it is sin. Let me just unpack that just for a couple of seconds here. The things that James is talking about right here are different than the commandments of God. He's not talking about murder or adultery, sexual fornication. He's not talking about stealing or lying. Those things are already clearly identified in Scripture as sin and contrary to the will of God. What he's talking about is this, in simple form. You're on your way home from church today, and you notice on the side of the road a car that has a person standing next to it with the hood open. And you notice that both hands are visible, and there is no cell phone in either hand. Or even if there was a cell phone in the hand. Do you assume that they don't need your help and drive by? Or has your heart told you, with the compassion of Christ, of faith in action, that you should at least stop and ask if they need any help? And if that thought of stopping and asking if they need help even for the slightest second crosses your mind, then you have been told and you know what is the right thing to do. And if you drive by and don't stop, for you, God says, you just sinned. You did not listen to the Holy Spirit of God giving you an opportunity to put your faith into action and to do good for another person. All you thought about was doing good for yourself and getting home because the roast might burn. You see? It's not a direct command of Scripture, but you know in your heart the right thing to do. And if you drive on by and don't do it, How long does it take you to forget that you just sinned? Or do you take it seriously? Because faith in action always takes sin seriously. And then the fourth thing we have to understand about life and God and who we are is this. We understand that our hope is not in the wealth of this world. Our hope is not in the wealth of this world. Now, I'm at that wonderful age of being reminded by letters almost weekly in the mail that in 1 year I'll be on Medicare. Social Security, if I choose to retire, which, by the way, I'm not planning on it at this point, but I'm not taking anything for granted until we get to that year from now and God's will says, stay at it. Not going to take the future for granted. You other pastors in the church better not either. But don't be working to assist the plan. And there comes a point where wisdom says, are you planned and prepared for that day when all of a sudden your source of income changes? And has God laid it on my heart to just say, I don't need anything because every day I wake up, God's going to provide me with something? Or am I at the point of others that say, I have to be so prepared that my future is so well laid out and I know where everything is going to come from that no matter what tragedy happens, I've got enough in reserve to cover my life? Or are you somewhere in the middle with a balanced approach of trusting God's will and God's provision while being faithful with what he has already provided? And James is speaking here to the people who are way over here on this extreme saying, we trust and put our hope for the security of life in everything that we have done to be able to prepare for the future. And God says, how foolish, because you're not even guaranteed of tomorrow. So at least if you're going to build those resources for the future, at least make sure you're going to give them back to the Lord when you're done and when you don't need them anymore. Oh, but my kids deserve a big inheritance. Really? Make them work for everything like you did. Give it to the Lord for the kingdom purpose. Or at least give him a big enough share that you can say, I was generous. I was generous. And I didn't trust my own security in the future and what I had prepared to take care of me. I'm still trusting God. We understand that our hope is not in the wealth of this world. And James warns about four things. Faith that wins does not hoard wealth. Faith that wins does not hoard wealth. Your riches have rotted and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded. You do not hoard wealth. Faith that wins also does not cheat people. He uses a specific example. You landowners, you've hired people to come in and mow your crops and harvest your crops, and then you didn't pay them and you kept all the profits for yourself. You cheater. If that's the wealth that you're going to count on having, I guarantee you, before you get to use it, I'm going to take it away from you because you cheated other people. You don't get wealthy by cheating others. Faith that wins does not live in self-indulgence. Verse 5, you have lived on the earth in luxury and in self-indulgence. You have fattened your hearts in a day of slaughter. Here's the word picture that James gives us. He gives us the picture of a cow. A cow that is being fed by the farmer all the prime protein carbohydrates necessary to make it fat 2 hours before it's going to be slaughtered. What a stupid investment in that cow. He's already as fat and as protein laden and as healthy as he's going to be if you're going to slaughter him 2 hours later. And yet we do the same thing in our lives. We don't none of us in here is guaranteed that we're going to live tomorrow. And yet, we're all making plans for how tomorrow we're going to increase our prosperity. Now, yeah, we have to be thinking about what I'm going to do at my job tomorrow. I have responsibilities. I'm going to be doing stuff. But if you're putting your hope in that so that you can be self-indulged with all of the profits, then James says, you're a fool. And the final thing that faith does that wins does not condemn others. It does not condemn others. You have condemned, verse 6, you have murdered the righteous person. He does not resist you. In other words, faith that wins does not look down on other people for what they have and what they're doing and then judge them and tell them that they're wrong, even to the point of hating them, to the point of being wishing they were dead. Because our hope is not in the wealth of this world. And the root cause of that kind of murder is, as we talked about last week, the jealousy, the bitter jealousy and the bitter envy that we have toward another person because they have more than we do and they don't deserve it, I deserve it. The self-indulgence and bitter jealousy that results in murder, and you can refer to last week's sermon for more details on that from the previous part of chapter 4 that James writes. We understand that our hope is not in the wealth of this world, and a faith that wins doesn't base its hope on what this world can offer you, but on what Christ has done for you. The next thing that James points out about faith that wins in this passage in verse 7, as he starts to talk to the brothers, the people of God, is that it is patient. Patient. I want you to be patient with me as we talk about patience. James gives us three examples of patience from Scripture that are to serve as our role models of how we base the decisions of our lives. The first example is the example of the farmer in verses 7 through 9 of James chapter 5. Be patient, therefore, brothers, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits. Three things are true about a farmer. Well, there's a lot of things true about a farmer, but at least for this context, three things are true about a farmer. Number one, he understands and accepts the laws of nature that dictate the growing conditions, the timelines, and the outcomes. He understands that. He understands that there's early rains, there's late rains. He understands that there could be hail in those rains that are going to destroy the crop. He understands that some of the seed might not germinate. He understands there might be a drought. Maybe I won't get the early rains or the late rains. Every single person who farms understands that everything could be lost because they are totally at the liberty of the laws of nature that dictate the growing conditions, the timelines for that growth, and the outcomes. So James says, you need to be patient like that farmer. And the first time a hailstorm comes and drops hail on a part of your crop, you don't go out and dig the whole crop up and start over. You wait. Maybe enough of the leaves weren't damaged that that crop will still develop. Maybe there were parts of it that weren't affected at all by the hail and you'll get a partial crop. Maybe God wants you to only have a partial crop this year. We are people that are great at knee-jerk reactions to anything that goes wrong. We're great at it, aren't we? Something goes wrong and we immediately go, oh, quick, I got to fix that. I got to take charge of this and I got to make the outcome happen that I desire. Not farmers. They just wait. They wait until the harvest. And then they just see what they got because somebody else is in charge of the timelines and the outcomes. And the reason he's able to wait is a farmer always keeps his eyes on the potential blessings of precious fruit. Do you see what James says there? He says he waits for the precious fruit of the earth. What have you declared to be precious to you in your life? Your wealth, your bank account, your job security, your family, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren, your soon-to-be children. What do you call precious in your life? The farmer only calls one thing precious, the product of his patience. The product of his patience is the only thing that's precious. And the product of our patience is the return of Jesus. The return of Jesus. When he says to us, your faith won. Your faith won. It all depends on what we determine to be precious. The farmer keeps his eyes on the potential blessings of precious fruit. He has established his life based on the promise of a harvest. The promise of a harvest. How do you define harvest? Only those things that benefit you? Or only those things that are a part of the purpose of God? I think I know I rededicate myself to this knowledge that on the day of the Lord's return, when I physically stand before him and he reviews my life for him, that I will not be in any way proud of what I did for me on this earth. And that I will not be ashamed, as John says in 1 John 2, I will not be ashamed of him at his appearing for all the things for him that I didn't do. But that I will stand before him and offer him his harvest of souls who have been brought to Christ by seeing my faith in action. Is there any other harvest that God declares righteous? And if we're not personally putting our faith in action to declare that the most important and most significant thing we can do with our lives is to bring our faith in action to bear on a faithless person so that they become a person who also have faith in Christ, then we have missed God's eternal redemptive purpose for living. The farmer establishes his life based on the promise of a harvest. The second example is the example of a prophet. A prophet who patiently endures suffering for the Lord. He says, you also be patient, verse 8, establish your hearts for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble against one another. As an example of suffering and patience, brothers, take the prophets, verse 10, who spoke in the name of the Lord. And that's all he says. We consider the ones blessed who remained steadfast in the midst of all of those hardships and trials of being a prophet, proclaiming the truth of God in a world that didn't want to hear it. It's unfortunate enough when the world doesn't want to hear the proclamation of the truth of God. It's even more horrifying to me when the body of Christ doesn't want to hear the truth of the Word of God. When the body of Christ says, oh, don't be so critical of that guy over there that's teaching that, because there's some elements of truth in it, so we should probably just accept the elements of truth and not worry about all the false teaching that's in it. Just so you know, the context of what I'm saying right there is that, just give you a prelude, there's been a lot of controversy about the movie that comes out of the book called The Shack. And I've been asked by numerous people what my opinion is. And in the beginning, I gave an opinion that was only based on critiques of the book from the past. And so this last week, my wife and I went to see the movie, The Shack, so that I could review it correctly. And there'll be a review being published this week on my blog for those of you that are interested. It will be a fair and balanced approach to the two good themes that were in the movie that present a reality of who God is. But it will also be balanced with a clear, distinct message from God's truth to the Christian church, warning about the false teaching that is also in that movie. It will be done graciously and gently, as gently as I can be. So pray for me as I write that. Okay, it could be a tool for you to use, but if you're going to use that as a tool to start a conversation with a person about God, there are some serious questions that you had better be able to answer, because that movie presents a false God in too many places. And you'd better be ready to use that as a tool to minister to someone else with the truth of who God is, and lead them to the truth that that's just maybe a door opening, but that door could lead to a wrong conclusion if you're not the guide to lead them to the right conclusion. So more on that later. The prophets were constantly persecuted for standing up for truth like that in their own culture. And it teaches us that we should endure suffering. Suffering will be the result of living righteously in the life of a God-fearing, faith-in-action person. And enduring that suffering must be our goal. And we must understand that God cares for us when we suffer. Just look at the Old Testament prophets. Elijah suffered under King Ahab, and yet God cared for him, gave him victory over the evil priests of Baal, provided for his needs when he got depressed. God cared for him. Jeremiah was arrested as a traitor, thrown into an abandoned well to die, but God fed him and protected him, even though it looked like he would be killed. Ezekiel and Daniel had their share of hardships, but the Lord delivered them and cared for them. And our patience to wait for the Lord's ultimate deliverance when he returns, our patience serves as a testimony of God's grace to others. Think about that. Your patience in the midst of hardship is a testimony of God's grace, because your patience is winning faith in action. He also uses Job. Let me read you a quote from Warren Wiersbe about Job and about patience that requires trials. Warren Wiersbe said it this way: "You cannot persevere in anything unless there is a trial in your life. There can be no victories without battles. There can be no peaks without valleys. If you want the blessing, you must be prepared to carry the burden and fight the battle." We look for ways out of the problems of life instead of the lessons God will teach us of winning faith in the midst of those lessons. It's difficult to find a greater example of suffering than Job. Circumstances were against him. He lost his wealth and his health. He lost his children. His wife was against him and said, "Curse God and die." His friends were against him and confused him of being the one deserving of that judgment because he had sinned. And it even seemed to Job like God was against him. And when he cried out for answers to his questions and didn't get an immediate reply, this is what Job said. He said, "Though he slay me, I will hope in him. For God is at work for the good of all those who are called according to his purpose and who love him." Patient endurance will bring the blessing of God. Well, in closing, winning faith is motivated by hope in the return of Jesus. Twice in this passage of verses 7 through 12, twice James says, "Because of the coming of the Lord, because of the coming of the Lord." I don't think there was probably a month that went by in my early days of growing up in my dad's church where he preached for all of those years. I don't think there was ever a month that went by that there wasn't a sermon on the coming of the Lord. We've kind of lost touch with that. We talk about the coming of the North Koreans more than we talk about the coming of the Lord. We talk more about the coming of spring than we do the coming of the Lord. We talk more about the coming disasters of the world than we talk about the coming of the rescue from the world. And yet winning faith is not motivated to live in this kind of activity unless it is motivated by hope in the return of Jesus Christ. James says two things in James chapter 5, 7, be patient, therefore, brothers, until the coming of the Lord. And in James 5, 8, he says, establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Two things. Number one, the return of Jesus Christ is our only hope and motivates us to patiently endure. And number two, the return of Jesus Christ is so imminent that we are challenged to be established right now. I want you to think about that for a moment. Pastor, what you said is really good. I appreciate it. I understand what God's word is trying to say, but there's some things I have to get worked out in my life, and when I get those worked out, then I will put these things into action. You're not guaranteed of the then. The Lord could return now! And just as you were scared right there about that, you're scared in your heart that you're not going to get done with what you had planned for the rest of the day. The return of Jesus Christ for his body, his bride, the church, is going to happen at any second. At any second. Are you established now with a winning faith in action to live your life? That word established is interesting. I want to close with this. The word established means to set fast. In other words, to turn resolutely in a certain direction. To turn resolutely in a certain direction. And this is the day of decision for you. Are you going to turn from the security of steadfast human wealth and prosperity to fully your hope in the return of Jesus Christ that has purchased your redemption for all eternity? And there is no joy that can be complete in anything this world offers. It will only be experienced fully in the presence of Jesus. Come quickly, please, come quickly. Have you turned resolutely and set yourself fast to that direction? To wait for the return of Christ. Here's your closing principle. Because our hearts are set on the return of Jesus Christ, we resolutely turn in the direction of his return and establish that direction as the course of our lives. And if you do that, you have a winning faith. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for this message today. We thank you for this study in James. It has been challenging and at sometimes even painful. But where it is applied in a humble spirit of trusting you, there is great reward. The rewards of peace and security. The rewards of hope and help. And I pray that today, we will, from this moment forward, resolutely turn to establish our way toward the coming of Jesus. I pray this in your name. Amen. The Levi team is going to minister to us in a song. I do not want you to stand, please, unless it's absolutely imperative that you do as your form of worship in response to it. But I want you to just be quiet. I want you to watch the words, read the words, listen to the words, apply the words, and apply what you've heard today. And then the director of our prayer ministry, Whitney Hall, is going to lead us in a closing time of Selah prayer as we make these points applicable to our own lives. Go ahead, Whitney.
We want to start off and read this scripture to you, Psalms 105, 1 through 4. Oh, give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him. Tell of all his wondrous work. Glory in his holy name, and let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord. I'm gonna read that part again. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence. Continually.
strip everything away. So all I have is you. Undo the veil till all I see.
Also, Dave Johnson shared with us this morning that there were a group of four girls that were a part of crew that were traveling back from a training session and had a head-on collision. And one of these girls is still in critical condition in the ICU. So we want to lift up those four girls. So if you're around Dave Johnson, get around him and pray for those young ladies. But then maybe you need to be alone today. Maybe you need to hit your knees right where you are. Maybe go find one of the elders. Maybe you need to pray with your family as you think about who you were pursuing. Notice I didn't say what you were pursuing. I didn't say if you were pursuing wealth or a name for yourself. I said who. Are you, like the scripture we just read, pursuing the Lord continually in everything that you do? It's His deeds that you're praising. It's His wondrous works. Or are you pursuing you? A name for yourself. What you can do on your own that you don't even need Him. Or what is your motivation behind pursuing the Lord? Is it really for only what He can give you? We're still very selfish in that at some times. I'm going to still follow you, Lord, as long as you bless me. So maybe this morning you need to get with your family. And like Pastor John said right there at the end, establish. We're going to make that mark in the ground right here, right now, today, that your family is going to be different from this point on. This is it. I'm making a resolution that I will pursue the Lord Jesus Christ in every area of my life. I'm going to pursue things of eternal value. I'm no longer going to fit God in my box. I'm not going to fit Him into what I think it should be, or fit Him into the things I still want to do, so I'm going to justify it. But maybe it's time I hopped into His box and say, here I am, Lord. Mold me. Make me. Take away this junk that's in there that doesn't need to be. Remove that veil so all I see is you. May our focus be on Him. So let's move now. Get wherever you need to be. If you need to be with your family, if you need to just be on your knees. And let's take this moment. And then in a moment, we're going to end with these words again. Don't sing them unless you mean them. So let's move now. Father, we just lay before you now. Just the words that we sang a minute ago. Search me inside. If there's anything that you find that brings you grief, Lord, make it known to us so that we can remove it and be far from it. Lord, may today we establish new families. And we say that our time is yours. Our money is yours. Our children are yours. Our marriage is yours. Myself is yours. My dreams, failures, everything, Lord, is yours. May we begin to pursue your face, Lord. Pursue your presence. So that everything that we do, Lord, we would see if it brings you honor and glory, not ourselves. Boy, it's exciting to think what you can do with a family that's on fire and passionate about pursuing you. Lord, what you can do with a church, Lord, that is on fire and passionate about pursuing you. It starts with one heart that's passionate about pursuing you. If this is your prayer, I want you to sing it with us.
Right now, right here, as we prepare to leave out, Lord, we ask you for this prayer, that we will pursue you no matter what it costs. No matter what it costs, Job, no matter what it costs, Father, we will pursue you. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Father, you can save us, but if not, we still will pursue you. Lord, help us have but if not faith. We will pursue you. Whatever it takes.
Thank you, Father, for this incredible day. For the patience of your people to hear the truth and apply it to their lives. Bless the rest of the activities of this day. And even today, Lord Jesus, interrupt our plans with your plan for the redemption of someone. And we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. As you're dismissed, if those of you that are volunteering to help with the load in for the concert and moving chairs and getting it all set up for the concert, if you would come right up front and meet me up here immediately, I would really appreciate that. If you're coming back to help as ticket taker or anything, come up front and tell me that, please. Thank you.
Taking care of me.